Merry Christmas, everybody. It's the 25th of December, and we had a live stream last night, but I'm just now showing you food places. I'll be making a little bit of news later. I don't have the microphone on, but I saw this nice cafe. It's really nice inside, so I thought I would just film and show it to you before anything. Some nutcrackers here. Very nice cafe here in Minsk. I'll show over here too. Dobry utro. Yes, tolka smotia YouTube.
No,
okay. Malinky, a small YouTube film. You speak English?
Yes.
Okay. Okay. It'll be on YouTube, so.
Great.
I've sat up here before. This is. I don't want to film the guests. They probably don't like it. So. Okay. More later. Bye bye. Good afternoon, everybody. It's 25th of December. Merry Christmas. Yeah, and it's a. Well, doing a little bit of raining out there. Well, it looks like it's slowing down. Maybe I can get out there and walk around when I'm huddled out over here and across the street from Minsk, Autozavodskaya. It's a place where they make a lot of the trucks. Thanks for a lot of places in the world, including like the West, even Sweden and places like that. I've seen movies with trucks made from this factory. Of course, this is just probably the main entrance of the main part of the factory part, but they got a lot of buildings in Minsk. And I don't really even know what those other buildings are for, but there's a large area, and I think you can see even over there in the distance, that's part of it as well. So, and it goes back a long distance that way too, where they're doing a lot of building of trucks and buses and things like that for Europe and everywhere else. So, but one of the messages I wanted to put out is a lot of stuff going on, a lot of collapses going on in places like Germany for the most part. You know, is a heavily industrialized place, and it was it's like they should have known that their prosperity is, for the most part, it was based on cheap Russian gas. And since they stood by and let the United States blow up the Nord Stream pipelines, of course they're not getting that, and then they're shutting down the pipelines on the land and thinking that they're doing a great job by weaning themselves from Russian energy and instead getting themselves attached to American energy, which costs four times more. And to thinking people, that doesn't make any sense. Get rid of one like addiction and get onto another one. I don't know, you can go into lots of spiels by that, and it's, like I said, it's all just a bunch of psyops, mind game sort of thing, played against the people, but the government certainly knows what they're doing. And I've always been saying that Olaf Scholz has compromised the Chancellor of Germany. And I think like people like Baerbock, Foreign Minister, and Habeck, these are American plants. And Baerbock, you'd think she's a Ukrainian plant because she loves Ukraine and wants to give everything that Germany has to Ukraine. And like just like Zelensky said last week, telling the United States, don't build your infrastructure, don't do anything like that. Don't do anything for the United States. Send all your money and send everything to Ukraine. I don't know if a lot of you saw that, but that was on television. He said, send everything to Ukraine, Americans. Yeah, what's going on? Who knows? Anyway, they think that, I don't know. I don't even like to talk about this stuff because it's all silly, and most of you already know that, because it's like a broken record. You know, this is all just nothing but a huge game, and the goal of the game is to try to collapse Russia, go into Russia, split it all up, and exploit its resources. And that's been the game for a long time. That was the game back in the time of Napoleon. That was the time of Adolf Hitler. How many times has the West tried to go after Russia and failed every time? But guess what? A lot of time it is a win, because the win goes to the military-industrial complex, and the loss goes to the people. It's just like what they call, that's what is that sort of a socialism they call them, where the losses are socialized, and whenever there's wins, they're privatized. So the rich people end up with all the money when it's a win, and when there's a loss, all the people, the little people, have to pay for it all. Something they all already knew instinctively, if nothing else. You know, we think we have a fairly decent living, and of course we do, but when you think about these rich people, they have so much money, they can live for five generations without ever working again and earning another penny. That's how things are. But let me put out a little bit of information first. We did a live stream last night, and of course we're mostly concentrating on Rumble because we get kicked off of YouTube because they don't really like the content that we talk about. And well, I'm on YouTube right now, and I'm not even going to, you know, it's medical related, and that's all I can say because I didn't even say anything, and neither did we on the podcast about this medical incident of a few years ago. Well, actually still going on. And they still deleted us and gave us a strike. So like I said, they deleted me and gave me a strike. And I just even saying the word medical, I'm afraid. You know, everybody else can get away with saying the C word, the V word, other things like that. But then YouTube sent me something and said, well, you're not really important enough. So, and it's, and I guess it's well known now that if you're not a channel that's gonna be getting them a lot of profits and you don't, and they don't like the message you're putting out, they're gonna go after you. And of course, I was the victim of one of those. I don't know, maybe you all know of other victims as well. There's people, I think that they've even made videos that talk about that, YouTube canceling them when they didn't even say what YouTube says that they're saying. But a lot of time, it's possible, and we are highly suspecting that that was somebody that was reporting us that in Minsk that sees us as too bad of a competition. You know, we're not 100% positive, but that's about what it was. And also, it looks like Dave is putting up an initiative to try to get donations for Donbass. He will put in the first $1,000 himself, and he's asking for people to send something. And if we can't get it there ourselves or arrange to get it there in any form over here, we are going to contact Mike Jones, Masha, and Jean-Marc Dugan. And of course, I'm sure they'll be glad to do that. Anybody that's contributing anything to the Donbass, a lot of those people, homes are bombed, losing everything. And Russia's paying already a lot for infrastructure, like Mariupol, building schools, things like that, repairing all the roads. You know, I don't know if Ukraine has come back and started bombing them again. Yeah, let me mention something about that too. Blinken, I think he just said yesterday, he came out and he's talking about how brutal Russia is and all of these things that, the very strange thing is, everything he's accusing Russia of, even Bucha, remember that? You know, those are all things that the West did, the United States and their agents, such as Ukraine. And of course, he didn't mention anything about Israel. And who's paying for all of these bombs? Who's putting the billions of dollars into these bombs that are destroying people? You know, here on Christmas, I didn't really want to get into a lot of this stuff, but it's all this film footage and the things that are going on. I think it was like, when was it, last night? At least in one raid last night, they killed 70 people, 70 innocent people, Israel. Yeah. But last night also in the podcast, I was, the live stream I was talking about, that Poland is now getting even more control. They're moving in and taking control. They basically force their way into the doors of the television to make sure they have total control of the narrative. You know, these are bad things. These are bad things going on right now. I can go into a lot more, but it's, like I said, it sounds more like I'm complaining, you know, because it has to do with us too. It has to do with everybody. But Poland, you know, they seek a war in the United States. I think it's the United States backing them and also pushing Germany. And I think Germany feels like, well, the United States destroyed us, and now we're obligated to go to war for them so they don't make it worse. I don't know. I'm really curious. Why would Germany purposefully destroy their own country? And just yesterday it was announced this big major steel industry in Germany closed its doors, and they had all the workers there watching. You know, a few hundred workers watching as the last pipe is going through. the very last pipe, and then they're shuttering their doors. Also announced that the fertilizer plants all over in the EU are closing. And here in Belarus, we have a lot of potash, so they, you know, potash is potassium, you know, when you think of the macronutrients that's needed in fertilizer. The biggest one is, of course, nitrogen, and then you have phosphate, and then you have potassium, and those are the letters that stand for those of the NPK. They always call that the NPK, so when you get fertilizer, you look at what percentage of those, you know, nutrients, so to speak, even though they're chemical, are in the fertilizer. So, and Belarus, they put out a lot of potash. So, and Russia puts out all of those things, but then the fertilizer plants, they're all closing down. A lot of the phosphate they can be getting from, there's a huge amount of phosphate in Morocco. It's not in Europe, but of course, I think that's where a lot of that would come from. And nitrogen, urea. Urea is a chemical, and of course it's 46% nitrogen. So that's where the where you can get the most nitrogen out of a fertilizer. You know, you throw it on with your hands and things like that. But I would highly suggest you wear gloves. It's not that it burns your hands right away, but over time, it you know, if you have it on your hands, I've seen it before, and you hold something in wood in your hand or your clothes will start to wear out a lot faster. And the handle on your shovel or whatever starts to deteriorate if you've had this stuff on your hands while you're using it. And then you wash your hands and of course like that. It's like it's not an immediate effect. It just kind of destroys things like that. So, but anyway, on our live stream, we were having 117 people watching, and there were about 7 people making comments. So actually this is growing. We started off, I think, with like 12 people, and then we had 20 and then 46 or whatever. And yesterday, I believe it was 117. And then we have confirmed quite a few guests. There's gonna be a guest coming on. He was this undertaker in the UK. And he was, when he was doing autopsies or whatever, preparing bodies for burial, he was the one noticing all of these things clogging up all the veins. And I guess I should stop right there because I'm starting to get into some forbidden territory about how that happened and what these people, what the status of these people were that had all these in their veins. So let me just end it there on that one. Yeah, so. Aristovich, who used to be the chief advisor of Zelensky, he's coming out and it looks like he has got a change of mind. He says that we were lied to, meaning the Ukrainians, that we were fooled. And now he looks like he's starting to slowly go on the side of Russia, believe it or not, which is very dangerous. I don't think he's coming quite right out and saying that, but because I believe he's still living in Ukraine, but he's realizing that the Ukrainian people have been duped, that they have been indoctrinated. And isn't it strange? Because it would be amazing if you see somebody, maybe himself, maybe he was indoctrinated, but it would be strange to see if this person can completely wake up. Because then it looks like it would be possible for the Ukrainian people to actually wake up and realize that they've been told lies for their entire adult life. As a matter of fact, not just their adult life, started out when they're in school and they were told about the evil Russians, everything that's Russian is bad, all the problems of Ukraine comes from Russia, 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 Russia. And that's of course what they're trying to do in the West, as everybody knows that, you see that. You know, anything that comes from Russia now that's going into Germany is virtually confiscated, just about everything, including Christmas gifts, things made of wood or plastic or anything. Everything is getting confiscated, you know, not just the money. You know, you can't just send any money over here anymore. That, you know, of course that includes Belarus. A lot of times when I'm talking, when I say stuff like Russia, it also means Belarus. So there is a union state. It's not quite the same country, but it is a union state. And what this channel is somewhat about, but more so our channel called From the Other Side. It's From the Other Side BY on YouTube, but we really won't be putting out that much information or doing much of anything on YouTube. I think it's banned right now. So we don't really even want to stream or do anything with YouTube because YouTube does not have any freedom of speech, really. they only go to a certain extent. And you can always put your foot in your mouth, and then somebody reports you that doesn't like you, and even though you never said it, they're going to delete you anyway, and there's no way to appeal because you're putting out information that they don't agree with, so they're going to cancel you. And they say they're going to up the ante, they're going to start deleting more people, and you know. So it looks like X from Elon Musk is starting to gain a lot more speed. A lot more people are going on there, and it's going to start to probably replace YouTube. As you know, Tucker Carlson is very big on X. So just saying. Okay. Anyway, ours was cut off, our live stream, when we were having Eva Laderdingerbach. Some say she's a politician in Netherlands, but maybe she's just an activist. Young, attractive young girl. Well, maybe not that young, but she's young to me. Everyone's young to me. And she was talking about what's really going on in the world in a very, very short segment. And we were playing that video, you know, about the global establishment and things like that. And I guess that's when our feed was cut, even on Rumble. But I'm not saying that Rumble did it, but there can be people that attack Rumble, and they got our feed cut. However, Dave is now paying more money. He's paying money every month now to get a different type of feed, and he contacted Rumble, and it looks like it's not going to happen again. So if you tune in to our live streams, which start at least on Minsk time, it's at 8 in the evening, 8 till 10 at night in our time, on Wednesdays and Sundays. So that'd be fantastic if you can join us. You can hear a lot of things you're not going to really hear much of anywhere else a lot of the time. And we're going to have even guests that have other channels, other Telegram channels, big channels that have over 100,000 people. The owner of one, DD Geopolitics, she has said she's going to come on our show. So we should be talking to her very soon. I don't know, January? I believe it'll be in January. So you'll want to join us for that. DD Geopolitics, like I said, on a very big channel and actually getting more and more popular. So it's going to be one of the biggest 3 to 5 channels on Telegram very soon. Okay, what else do we have here? There's a lot of other information. You know, like I said, I already mentioned something about Gaza, and the war has not yet started, apparently, against the Houthis. So supposedly this big coalition, a lot of these people withdrew, or they were never in it in the first place. Maybe they just reported, yeah, these people are all with us, France and who else, everything. And a lot of these countries pulled out. So it's the United States and I believe the superpower of Seychelles and the mighty, mighty, mighty Estonia, I think, are still on board. I don't know who else. Probably the UK, obviously. If Germany isn't, you know, they're a puppy dog from the States. So if they were in the first place, they're still in. I don't know. They used to have laws that they couldn't be engaging in any of these foreign activities, you know, since World War II. I think it was the Allies that made them come up with a doctrine of not engaging in any foreign military entanglements. But that was that was strange when it happened to Iraq. And I think it was Donald Rumsfeld, the Secretary of Defense at that time, he was yelling and screaming at Germany for not... He was yelling and screaming at Germany for the doctrines that the U.S. forced upon them. You can't make this stuff up. Okay, what else do we have here? I was mentioning something also about Trump, and apparently the news has come out that was actually George Soros and the Democratic Party that arranged to get him taken off of the ballot in Colorado. And so some other states were also thinking about getting him off the ballot, and now the Republicans are also now threatening to try to get Joe Biden taken off of the ballots in their states. So, oh, what a tangled web we weave. So you can go into that sort of thing. Anyway, that's mostly what I want to put out. I could have put out a lot more news and a lot of things going on. A lot of things I was talking about yesterday in our podcast. But like I said, I don't want to get into too much of this stuff anyway. Hey, one thing that I thought was pretty bad, you know, can announce this on Christmas time. There were churches inside of Gaza, you know, where refugees were staying, and these are Christian churches, I guess. And I believe some of the people of those churches, I heard two different stories, that they contacted the Vatican, and the Vatican contacted Ukraine and gave them the coordinates and said, don't bomb these places because these are innocent people in those places. And someone said that it was gone through the Senate, through the United States Senate, or maybe it was even through both. And the Senate contacted Israel and said, don't bomb these places. These are just civilians in this place. And Israel bombed them and killed them. So, you know, that's par for the course for Israel. You know, I guess they think that's pretty funny, you know, because a lot of time you see how overjoyed they are when they, really makes you wonder. They're overjoyed. I was thinking the Ukrainians are bad, you know, when they got this ideology of Nazism and, you know, they have this inner desire because that's how they were raised. They were indoctrinated since babies almost to hate Russians and to want to go out and kill them. Thank you for the United States. That's what the United States did that. In Israel, it's a little bit different, you know, but these people as well, and they think they're doing a very good service to humanity when they're killing Palestinians, especially babies. When you kill babies, when you kill children, that's genocide. You know, I don't care what people say. You know, I was the one that started talking about ethnic cleansing. You know, even when the Russians were talking about what the Ukrainians are doing in the Donbass region, they're saying genocide, genocide. But that isn't genocide. But when you do purposefully kill children, I would call that genocide. Because obviously you're trying to wipe out future generations, starting with the children, and the children can't have children because they're dead. I mean, obviously. Okay. I don't know. I'm not so funny anymore. You know, you're putting out this bad news about all this stuff going on, because you can't be funny when you have all these children getting killed everywhere. Oh, I got something in my eye. And it was already bad enough, you know, in the Donbass. But anyhow, there was something funny on there. I don't know if I can find it and maybe put it on this video. I doubt it. It's too long, I think. And I think it's in the United States. They're doing some news thing about some very, very terrible, 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 terrible guy. Heartless, heartless, heartless young guy. He's going around in some town, and he did it to 7 places. He picks like a post-it, you know, those little sticky pieces of paper, and he writes the letter Z on them, and he sticks it on the door of some businesses. Can you imagine? These people, they're going to be traumatized for their entire life because they saw a post-it with a Z written on it on their door. What a heartless and brutal, brutal person that could do something like that. Talk about stupid friggin' news, you know? I guess that's part of the indoctrination. Part of the indoctrination the United States is pulling on the people themselves. Anybody watching this channel, none of you are that stupid to be falling for this kind of stuff, you know? Gosh, it was just so funny. Maybe I can find that and post it. You know, you guys can get a laugh, at least something funny on Christmas anyway. Okay, but that's about it for right now. And I don't know when I'm gonna be making the next video. Of course, we have our next live stream. Of course, it's gonna be on Wednesday. And what is that? That's the 27th of December. And I hope you join us for that. The last one was very good, and if you didn't see it, then you should go tune in and look on our site on From the Other Side. You'll find it and watch it. That's very good. Dave has put it all together, even the part that was when it was cut off from Rumble. I think he found the rest of that, and I think he put it all together. We're even talking about what happened. We're cut off. Okay. Well, that's about it for right now. Thank you very much for joining you, and again, Merry Christmas, and if I don't talk to you before that time, a Happy New Year. Bye-bye. Very important news, because it has a little bit of a relationship to what happened here in Belarus in 2020. They're trying now to use a color revolution and overthrow Serbia. I think I even said that in one video at some time, that you can expect that to be happening. You know, we're watching these hot spots like all the rest of you are, like Armenia, Azerbaijan, around that area, and course, the Kosovo and Serbia sort of a deal, where the U.S. is trying to overthrow Serbia as well, you know, like they did Kosovo. And yeah, well, they tried that yesterday. I think they're trying to say, matter of fact, somebody put something out and said, we don't need another Belarus, you know, and they're talking about corruption and all kinds of things that, of course, is not really even true at all about Belarus. So even some of the people here, they believe that, but it's not really true. You know, there's a little bit of corruption in every single country. Try to compare Belarus to Germany. Compare Belarus to the United States. Compare Belarus to the UK. And then try to tell me that there's corruption, big corruption here in Belarus. You know, oh, where's Lukashenko's palaces? Where's his yachts and his many houses like Ukraine and all that? I mean, come on, you know. They believe that they can say it, then it makes it true. Remember in Putin, they're saying it was Putin's palace or something like that down near Sochi, which actually I think it was closer to Tuapse. But of course, that turned out to be completely false. They showed you pictures inside and, you know, and then somebody went to that place and showed you that it was completely completely unfinished. There is no library inside or nothing like that. And that library was found to be in Budapest or something somewhere. So that was Navalny. And then some people are still believe in Navalny. Isn't that incredible? You get indoctrinated to a point and you just, you can't get it out of your head. So that's what's amazing, like I said, about Arestovich. It looks like he's kind of shrugging off a lifetime of being indoctrinated. So that's going to be interesting to see if he can really pull that off. You know, because I think it might be generous, or it might be genuine that he actually is really shrugging off indoctrination. That would be totally amazing. I guess I would have to put him up a notch in my book. I guess that puts him at notch one. So that's about that. And also, I should say something about what I put here. I don't know where I'm going to put it in this video. Might put it at the end, might put it at the beginning. I went into a cafe. It's got some nice big nutcrackers on the outside. And I talked to the lady, young lady inside there, and speaks very good English. So if you guys, any of you that are in Minsk, you know, you might want to check out that coffee shop. It is on the Frunzinskaya, right near the metro, one of the metro exits or something, when you can get out there and see that. And it's, what is it, also in that direction. Let me see if I can give you some little better directions. But, you know, Frunzinskaya, I think there's like four ways to exit the metro. So you might get off on the wrong one. But anyway, you'll notice it. You'll notice it. I guess you'll have to try all four until you get off on the right one, get off on the right exit out of the metro. Okay, well, it's starting to rain a little bit, so I guess I better shut this off. I just thought I would throw that information out. It's very important about Serbia, so let's see what happens there. And I guess, let me put out a little bit about that. Serbia, what happened was, I guess the Russians found out a lot about that, and they told Serbian government that actually won the election, that really won the election, that this sort of thing is coming around, that there is going to be an attempted overthrow. And I think the only amount of people that showed up for this, even though it looks like it's a lot, but it's only like 2,400 people, which is very small. And it was kind of similar in Belarus. You know, it looks like a lot of people, and they ship a lot of people in and they put them all in one place. And this is all done for photo opportunities to make it look like it's a lot more people than what you think. So, but there was probably more in Belarus at that time, because you know, Belarus is kind of an innocent country, and they were indoctrinating people for a much longer period of time here before that went down. Isn't that strange? When I was going around in Europe before, you go to different countries and you see people like, I went into Bulgaria, you'd see the Bulgarians, and I see the Ukrainians. There were a place we were staying, and they had Ukrainians staying there too. And they all said how much they liked Lukashenko. And you even have Russian people said the same thing. And all these people are saying, oh, we wish we had a leader like Lukashenko. And now they were using psyops. Of course, this is a psyop, and Poland has admitted that they were using psyops to try to mess with the minds of the Belarusians. Anyway, it's a psyop to get people to hate their leaders and want to overthrow them by coming up with a bunch of BS and saying, oh, they're stealing money, or they have harems full of women, or they have palaces or yachts and stuff like that. And then the ones that are really corrupt, you know, they just kind of, even though everybody knows they're corrupt, they don't organize anything. It takes a little bit of money too. It takes a couple million dollars to get these people. And then you pay for their buses and you ship them to certain places. Like say, oh, you're going on a nice nice excursion to Minsk and all that sort of stuff. Everything's paid for, you get food and all that. So anyway, there's a lot of different ways how they engineer all these protests and stuff like that. So I just thought I'd put that out, and I don't know if I'm putting this on. We'll see you for the next one. Thanks for joining me. Bye-bye.
And as President Zelensky makes that visit here to the U.S., the Ukrainian community in Chicago is speaking out about what they say are several hate crimes in the last 24 hours.
WGN's Brona Tumulty is live for us this afternoon with more. Brona?
Good evening, guys. Yeah, it's understood 7 locations at least here in the Ukrainian village were tagged yesterday with the letter Z or Z, as you can see on the doors of the National Museum here behind me. It's considered a pro-Russian symbol, often seen on Russian military vehicles. So to have it pop up here, we're told, sends a very specific message.
It's a symbol of genocide. It's a symbol of murder, of rape, of innocent civilians, of children being kidnapped. So it's not just a letter for us. It's a lot more.
Danilo Butenko runs a veterinary practice in Ukrainian village, and yesterday found the place tagged with the letter Z, which is so much more than just a letter to some.
The letter Z for Ukrainians is not just a letter. It is a symbol of a nation that is attacking another peaceful nation without cause, without provocation.
His business, we're told, one of at least 7 locations in the surrounding area vandalized in this way in the last 24 hours, among them the Ukrainian National Museum. Their cameras catching a potential suspect, sign in hand, making his move around 12:40 Monday afternoon.
On the video, you can see that it's a guy walking and looking on his phone, and then he's taking photos of what he's accomplished.
Steve Dimitro from the museum telling us the Ukrainian population here has grown by about 30,000 in the course of the war, as particularly women and children flee their home country.
These are kids who, back home in Ukraine, their schools were blown up, their houses were blown up, their family and friends were killed by tanks bearing this emblem. These kids are traumatized. It's extremely serious that this stop.
These incidents happening just ahead of President Volodymyr Zelensky's visit to D.C.
It is a warning to us as a Ukrainian community, and it is a warning to the United States that Russian sympathizers and agents are here in Chicago and everywhere in the United States.
And while most of those impacted have torn down the tags, we're told they'll remain on high alert.
We have security in place, and we're talking with the staff now to see what we can do to make it better.
Now, we had to blur the person seen on the surveillance video because they haven't actually been charged with anything as of right now, but we're told police do have that footage. We're still waiting to hear back from authorities about whether this is indeed being investigated as a hate crime. We're live in Ukrainian village. Bruno Tumulty, WGN News.